this is the Comic Made Man. We're here on this Monday remembering the life and times of Stan Lee.
Stan Lee was a big impact on our lives with all his creations and his co-creations. How about you, Kavora?
Yes, I think he was a big influence. Mostly I remember watching a lot of the Marvel cartoons and TV shows.
That was the first time I've ever heard his voice, was when he introduced the Spider-Man and his amazing friends.
That's what I remember, too. This is Stan Lee.
I definitely remember him. I don't remember him from the show. Well, I guess I sort of remember now. But I remember him mostly because he was featured all the Marvel comics in the 70s and 80s, especially when he would do the Stan Lee soapbox, which was present in pretty much every comic.
It was something where he would just give his opinion on the, you know, not about comics, right, but about the real world.
Yes. I don't remember exactly. I just remember it was in every comic. But yeah, he was instrumental in creating, I mean, he basically created a whole separate universe, an alternate universe, which millions have enjoyed since. I mean, he pretty much got started with when Marvel was actually Timely Comics back in the late 1930s, and then he became an editor there, and where he started collaborating with Jack Kirby, and they continued that until the 60s, where they rebranded as Marvel, and then they just created, obviously, everything that you and I know. Fantastic Four, X-Men, Hulk, Spider-Man, Black Panther. I mean, a whole host of characters. I mean, it can't be stated enough the profound effect that he's had pretty much on America and American culture. He and Jack Kirby actually appear as versions of themselves in Fantastic Four 10. If anybody wants to go back and check it out.
Neat. So he made cameos not just in movies but also in his own comics.
He did.
We were talking about Stan Lee's soapbox, and there was one famous Stan Lee soapbox from 1968 Marvel Comics. Kavor, would you like to read that? And let's just think about the social climate that was going on in America in the late 1960s and how important this was to be able to express this.
Okay, this is Stan's soapbox. Let's lay it right on the line. Bigotry and racism are among the deadliest social ills plaguing the world today. But unlike a team of costumed supervillains, they can't be halted with a punch in the snoot or a zap from a ray gun. The only way to destroy them is to expose them, to reveal them for the insidious evils they really are. The bigot is an unreasoning hater, one who hates blindly, fanatically, indiscriminately. If his hang-up is black men, he hates all black men. If a redhead once offended him, he hates all redheads. If some foreigner best him to a job, he's down on all foreigners. He hates people he's never seen, people he's never known, with equal intensity and equal venom. Now, we're not trying to say it's unreasonable for one human being to bug another, but although anyone has the right to dislike another individual, it's totally irrational, patently insane, to condemn an entire race, to despise an entire nation, to vilify an entire religion. Sooner or later, we must learn to judge each other on our own merits. Sooner or later, if man is ever to be worthy of his destiny, we must fill our hearts with tolerance, for then and only then will we be truly worthy of the concept that man was created in the image of God, a God who calls us all his children. So that was Stan Lee's soapbox for one issue.
Pretty profound. I mean, I'm definitely telling of what was going on in America at the time. And he also incorporated a lot of it into his work, too. I mean, he also was the one where, I think it was Amazing Spider-Man, which detailed prescription drug abuse. And he was reprimanded by the CCA, the Comic Code Authority. And he actually, that issue alone was instrumental in them relaxing their stringent codes and allowing drug abuse and other taboo subjects to be incorporated into comics.
What were some of your favorite moments in Stan Lee's history, either his personal history or his creation?
As far as his creations, I mean, you got to think about it. Superman and Batman are the most popular superhero icons, but Spider-Man, Hulk, they're not far behind at all. they're not trailing far behind. So you have to think that this put in perspective now. It's almost 2019. But without him, none of this would have happened.
Correct.
There would be no Marvel Universe for people to enjoy movie-wise. I mean, we're remembering Stan Lee as the comic book writer. We're not thinking about Stan Lee also as the entrepreneur, where, you know, he also negotiated for the Marvel movies. Because we think about, we also look back
to the TV shows.
Well,
Incredible Hulk.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it was a complete rise and fall because Marvel's popularity was peaking in the late 60s, in the 70s, and also in the 80s. But it came to a crashing halt in the 90s, where they sold off most of their properties. He was always an entrepreneur. I mean, that's one thing that also keeps that in mind, is that he also found a way to market and push the Marvel products into pretty much different avenues or realms of business. So he also, 90s, when they crashed and they ended up selling Spider-Man properties mm-hmm. to Sony, they ended up selling Fantastic Four, X-Men to Fox. But you have to think that they also had the wherewithal to pull it back in.
And it's not just him.
At this time, too, Marvel had pretty much dropped the reins, but he's also the key face behind Marvel.
Left Marvel, he was still associated with them. Kavor, what are some of your favorite moments of Stan Lee?
I know one thing he did that was different. He had a show that was on the Sci-Fi Channel that was called Who Wants to Be a Superhero? And this was like right at the time when all these, you know, reality shows were on TV. So Stan Lee got to do one that had these, you know, ordinary people who made up their own superhero persona, and Stan Lee had them doing different tasks every week. It was really a fun show, and it was fun seeing him every week. And you get to see the guy, he's really nice, and he talked to the people, like, in a way that, you know, he was their leader, they all respected him. It was a fun show.
And that was unique about Stan Lee, is that as he left Marvel Comics, he's never stopped caring about Marvel creations and superheroes in general. And we look at other comic book publishers, no one else is in the forefront in the public's eyes like he was for his entire life.
Well, I think that's one of the key things behind his creations, too. Versus like DC, all their things are, you respect them as superheroes, people you can't relate. Versus Marvel was like, the approach that he always wrote was that these could be your friends, and they got the power, they got superpowers, and what do they do then? You know, it's like it was way more humane, or written on a human level.
The flaws were celebrated. He made sure that some had money problems, some had some sort of addiction, some had frustrations with relationships.
Yeah, Peter Parker. Look at Peter Parker. He's like, all right, well, I'm a superhero pretty much, or moonlighting as a superhero, but I'm also like this nerdy teenager. I've got all sorts of girl problems.
Yeah.
You know, I've got to deal with this dickhead named Flash Thompson, you know.
They're all things that a teenager could relate to.
Absolutely. I mean, and that's why Spider-Man is probably their most popular character by far.
Well, I have two favorite memories of Stan Lee. One was a few years back. He was the Grand Marshal of the Dragon Con parade. Kavor and I were actually in that parade. We were marching with the Star Trek group. We're always in the Star Trek group in costume. And to have him as a Grand Marshal of the parade and march behind him was amazing in itself. And then another instance, Kavor and I went to Wizard World Comic Con in Nashville in 2017, and we were in attendance in the audience. Gene Simmons of KISS would go to the Marvel offices in the 70s asking Stan Lee's input on different costume designs. And especially when the KISS comic book came out, that is Marvel Super Special number 1, the band was involved in putting their blood into the red ink of the comic. So I asked Stan, what was it like to work with KISS, and what was your experience with having the blood poured into the ink of Marvel Super Special number 1? Let's listen to his response.
Gene Simmons came up to the office, followed by these other guys, and said, I want to ask you a question, Stan. I said, all right. He said, do you think this looks too outrageous? And he put on these shoes the heels were about 6 inches and stood that high when it was all finished in costume. And, you know, I'm used to guys like Dr. Doom and the Vulture and stuff. So I said, no, that's not outrageous at all. And he said, thank you. And we talked a little and he left. And I'd like to think that I'm the reason that his looks the way they look. If I had said it looks too outrageous, he'd probably have thrown it all away. Oh, the blood. Another thing. I will never forget this. He said, you know, my fans love us so, the KISS people. What I would like to do is offer them a chance to get... We were doing a KISS comic book at the He said, I'd like to offer them a chance to get a KISS comic book that has our blood in it so they could own a little bit of our blood. I said, what are you talking about? And it ended up, we drove to Buffalo where the books were printed, and the KISS guy stood in the room with the inkers that they print the book out of, and each of them stuck a little needle in his finger and let a few drops of his blood get into the ink so we could advertise for that issue of the book. You're buying a copy of KISS with their own blood in it. Boy, did that sell out. We must have some bloodthirsty viewers and readers out there.
In fact, we're going to end this segment with some of the quotes that our listeners have expressed on Facebook, as well as some of the messages that they sent to us via voice on starpodlog@gmail.com.
Okay, so first we have Dan Emerson. He says, when I saw Stan Lee at Wizard World Madison, I was in the front row. Magical. And we have Brian Buescher, and he said, in Mallrats, a great movie with Stan Lee. And we have Andrea Barron. She says, he was such an American icon. Yes, he was. Those are all great memories of Stan Lee.
Hey, everybody. Steve Geiger here. I'm coming to you from Buffalo, New York, in the middle of a snowstorm. A surprise, right? I'm here to talk about Stan Lee and what he meant to me and his influence on me. It was tremendous and huge. Since I was a child, I was watching Marvel cartoons in the early 60s. And later in the 70s, when I started collecting comic books, I became aware of Stan himself and was very impacted by all his writing, the world he created. I immersed myself in it and then at some point decided I would give it a try, do it professionally, and do the art myself. And I was lucky enough to able to work in the industry for these last 30 years and work for Marvel in particular for a long time. Still do a few things here and there. I am very saddened by his passing. He was a true genius and a very, very nice man. He meant a lot not only to me but to the world at large. The impact of the movies that have been made from the mythology created and all the merchandising worldwide just goes to show what he meant not only to me but to everyone almost around the world. And he will be sorely missed. Even though he is gone, his influence will remain with me as I continue to create comics. And Stan, I say to you, thank you very much for the opportunity you gave me and the life you gave me. If not for you, I would not be doing this. And I also wanted to say to you, Excelsior, and Valhalla has received a true champion this week.
Hello, this is Robert Garza from Lubbock, Texas. I first heard of Stan Lee by seeing his photo in the inside cover of the historic giant-sized comic, Superman vs. Spider-Man. I was amazed by the characters he helped create. I also remember him hosting the video adaptation of the book, How to Draw the Marvel Way. So in a way, he helped teach me how to draw. Excelsior.
Thanks for listening. Make sure you hit that subscribe button and join our Facebook group. Live long and may the force be with you. Nanu, nanu.